The World Wrestling Federation presents a double main event. It's SummerSlam 1990, taking place on August 27th, 1990, from the Spectrum in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. The attendance for this show was a sellout 19,304, the live gate was $338,452, and the pay-per-view buys were 507,000. This would be the final WWF pay-per-view to reach 500,000 or more buys until WrestleMania 14 in March 1998. Now, compared to SummerSlam 1989, all the metric numbers for 1990 were lower compared to the year before, and compared to the rest of the WWF pay-per-views in 1990, SummerSlam was second in attendance, live gate, and pay-per-view buys, with WrestleMania 6 being the highest in all three categories. Your commentators for the night were Vince McMahon and Roddy Piper. No Jesse Ventura here, as he had recently just left the company over a dispute. This would be the first WWF pay-per-view in history without the body a part of it. And in the dark match, Shane Douglas defeated Buddy Rose. The opening match at SummerSlam 1990 was scheduled to be a tag team match, The Rockers, Shawn Michaels, and Marty Jannetty versus Power and Glory, Paul Roma, and Hercules. In the build of the match, The Rockers came to save Roma from an attack, but there was some confusion between the two sides. Hercules came out and tried to play peacekeeper, but ended up siding with Roma and then attacking Shawn and Marty. While this was scheduled to be a tag team match, and officially still was, this match was worked more as a handicap match because before the match, Shawn was attacked in his knee and never got into the match. This was done due to Shawn injuring his knee for real in the lead up to SummerSlam. They had to write him off for a while by having his knee attacked pre-match. Now, for what was essentially a handicap match, this opener was really solid. Marty had control at the start, but then the numbers game. Marty mounted a somewhat comeback, but then the numbers game yet again, leading to the awesome Powerplex finisher from Power and Glory for the win, as Power and Glory defeated the Rockers in 6 minutes. Next up was the first of three championship matches on the night. This one was for the World Wrestling Federation Intercontinental Championship. Now, the plans for this prior to July 4th was to have Mr. Perfect defend his championship against Brutus Beefcake. Beefcake had beaten Perfect at WrestleMania. With that, once Perfect won the IC title, Beefcake would be the logical challenger at SummerSlam. They would have matches starting on the house shows in early summer. But then on July 4th, Brutus Beefcake's career was put on hiatus after a parasailing accident that crushed his face, requiring a shit ton of wires and screws to reconstruct it. With that, those plans were off the table, and for a while, it was being announced that Mr. Perfect would be defending his title at SummerSlam, opponent to be named later. That opponent would end up being the Texas Tornado, Kerry Von Erich. Very little hype and build to this one. They used that as the story here, how Perfect had little time to prepare for Tornado. The match here was okay for the time they were given. I wish they could have gotten more time here, but given Kerry's handicap, you probably couldn't have gone much longer. You got the claw, the discus punch, and in no time, it's over and a brand new champion, as the Texas Tornado defeated Mr. Perfect in 5 minutes 15 seconds to win the Intercontinental Championship. Match number 3, if you can even call it a match, and I won't, Queen Sherry versus Sapphire. This had been going on since the Royal Rumble when they had their interaction on the Brother Love show. You had the mixed tag at WrestleMania where Dusty Rhodes and Sapphire won. Here at SummerSlam, you would have the men of that match face each other, and then the women of that match facing each other, except that's not what we ended up getting. Queen Sherry would show up, but Sapphire didn't. The referee counted to 10, Sapphire still didn't show up, so the match was over. And this began the show-long angle of, where is Sapphire? In the record book, technically, Queen Sherry defeated Sapphire by forfeit in 0 minutes, 0 seconds. Following that was originally supposed to be the long-awaited one-on-one pay-per-view match where the Strike Force exploded, Tito Santana versus Rick Martel. At WrestleMania 5 back in April of 89, Martel abandoned Tito during their match with the Brainbusters. This started the feud between the two. Nearly a year and a half later, it was still going on, and we were meant to have a match here between Martel and Tito. But in kayfabe, Martel was unable to compete here due to a modeling gig in France. In reality, this was done to cover up an injury. So in Martel's place, we got the Warlord to take on Tito Santana, and this was done to get the Warlord over after the split of the Powers of Pain. Tito got a little bit in, but this was more or less a squash match, running power slam, and it's over, as the Warlord defeated Tito Santana in 5 minutes 28 seconds. Now we get to something truly amazing. Match number 5, the second of 3 championship matches on the night. This one was for the World Wrestling Federation Tag Team Championships, contested under 2 out of 3 falls rules. Champions Demolition, Smash and Crush versus challengers The Hart Foundation, Bret Hart and Jim Neidhart. Demolition were in their 3rd reigns as tag team champions when Axe and Smash defeated the Colossal Connection at WrestleMania 6. And that shows where this story begins, as after the Hearts squashed the Bolsheviks at WrestleMania, they claimed dibs on the number one contendership spot. Colossals or Demolition, it didn't matter who were the champions, the Hart Foundation were the next in line. Demolition were now the champs once again, but in early June they added a 3rd member in Crush. Axe's health was an issue at this point, so Crush started replacing Axe, and the trio invoked the Freebird rule. Also, with the Road Warriors coming into the company, Demolition went heel once again. What we got here between these two teams was one of SummerSlam's best matches ever, as well as one of the best tag team matches in company history, and also a great swan song for the great 80s tag team division in the WWF. Demolition took the first fall, Hearts took the second fall, Demolition was switching members to keep up the numbers game, eventually the Road Warriors came out to combat Demolition's cheating, Ref was distracted, Bret behind Crush, Anvil slingshot tackles Crush over Bret, 1, 2, 3 brand new champions, as the Hart Foundation defeated Demolition 2 falls to 1 in 14 minutes 24 seconds to win the tag team championships. Match number 6 with special referee the Big Boss Man, Jake Roberts versus Bad News Brown. As was tradition with most of Jake's opponents, Bad News had a fear of snakes. He got a rubber snake in a box and was in total fear of it. Once the match was set here for SummerSlam, Bad News decided he was going to combat Damien with Harlem sewer rats. You had the rat cage under a black covering here at ringside, but they were never revealed during the match, and yeah, this match was complete shit, and it would end up being Bad News' final match in the WWF after a run that started off pretty good, but soon went downhill. Bad News hit Jake with a chair and a disqualification. Jake Roberts defeated Bad News Brown by DQ in 4 minutes 44 seconds. After that was the big non-wrestling segment for SummerSlam 1990, an episode of the Brother Love Show. His guest was recent returnee and turncoat Sergeant Slaughter, who presented Brother Love with the Great American Award. This was following Slaughter's return and how he thinks America has gone soft, this of which was during the time Iraq invaded Kuwait, the eventual start of the Gulf War, which the U.S. joined in January 1991. The kayfabe behind Slaughter's turn was due to the American crowd, except in Nikolai Volkov. Speaking of Volkov, after that was the next match, a tag team match, Nikolai Volkov and Jim Duggan versus the Orienten Express Sato and Tanaka. After all those years of being an anti-American heel, Volkov was now a pro-Western babyface. This was during the time where the Cold War was coming to an end, and some of the Soviet heels in wrestling were being turned babyface. With this one, he was paired with Jim Duggan. They had a short-lived tag team, kind of the WWF's version of the Superpowers, though not as good as the real Superpowers. This match was done to get Duggan and Volkov over as a team. Similar to Warlord and Tito earlier on in the night, this was basically a squash match. Duggan three-point stance, Old Glory clothesline with a splash for the win, as Jim Duggan and Nikolai Volkoff defeated the Orient Express in 3 minutes 22 seconds. Match number 8 was the conclusion of the show-long Where is Sapphire story as Randy Savage took on Dusty Rhodes. The build for Sherry and Sapphire, well, that applies to this match here as well. Once we get to the show, Dusty is a bit preoccupied as he had been looking for Sapphire all night once she didn't show up for her match with Queen Sherry. She was briefly seen before going into a room, refusing to talk to anyone. Then prior to the match starting, Ted DiBiase revealed that he had bought Sapphire. See, prior to SummerSlam, Sapphire was being bought expensive gifts from a mysterious person. That mysterious person was revealed here to be Ted DiBiase. Dusty is distracted by all of this. Match goes on, and the match is roughly 2 minutes. This whole story here could have been done on Saturday night's main event the month prior, and not here on SummerSlam. Match ends. Post-match, Dusty chases after DiBiase before he leaves in a limo. But here in the match, Randy Savage defeated Dusty Rhodes in 2 minutes 15 seconds. Next up began the double main event of SummerSlam 1990. In the first half, you had Hulk Hogan versus Earthquake. This was a grudge match being built up since May, when Earthquake attacked and squashed Hogan on an episode of the Brother Love Show. Now, we had seen this multiple times before with Hogan. They do an injury angle with him, but they treated this as a serious matter this time, like, he may not come back this time. This may be the end of Hulkamania once and for all. They even played a tribute video for his career afterwards. With Hogan's future in doubt, the biggest Hogan mark and new Hogan mate Tugboat was telling the fans to write in letters and postcards to encourage Hogan to come back to wrestling. In July, Hogan made his return and said he was coming back to the ring, and a match was set for SummerSlam between Hogan and Earthquake. Now, why was this and the actual main event called a double main event? Well, Hogan wasn't in the title match and wasn't going on last, but his match was still a huge deal, so we'll call it a main event anyways, even though it wasn't. Originally, Tugboat was supposed to be in Hogan's corner to combat Dino Bravo and Jimmy Hart, but he was replaced by the Big Boss Man, who was pulling double duty after Tugboat was kayfabed injured prior to the show. Hogan vs. the Monster had been seen a ton of times by this point. It had its own formula. But not for nothing, though, this match between Hogan and Earthquake was still really good. The finish of it kept Hogan strong, and it kept Earthquake strong. They fight to the outside. Hogan slammed Quake onto a table that didn't break. You get the count-out finish. Post-match, Earthquake choked Hogan, and it took 3 chair shots from the Boss Man until Earthquake felt pain, as Hulk Hogan defeated Earthquake by countout in 13 minutes 16 seconds. With 9 matches down and 1 more match to go, it's now time for the second half of the double main event and the actual main event of SummerSlam 1990. This was the third of 3 championship matches on the night, a steel cage match for the World Wrestling Federation Championship. Champion the Ultimate Warrior versus challenger Rick Rude. Ultimate Warrior was in his first reign as WWF Champion, defeating Hulk Hogan at WrestleMania 6. With all the top heels already doing something on this show, they decided to go back to Warrior versus Rude. When it came to televised matches, Rick Rude had been the only person up to this point to have pinned the Warrior, having done so at WrestleMania 5. They had their rematch the year prior at SummerSlam 89 with Warrior getting his win back, then they went on to do their own separate things, came back during the summer of 1990, they had a match on Saturday night's main event 1 month earlier with Warrior winning by DQ, you had the rematch set here for SummerSlam inside a steel cage. Now, the match itself was good, but the feud seemed really cold compared to the year prior. Also, the marquee feud heading into this show was Hogan versus Earthquake. Really shocked that didn't go last, and you knew Rude wasn't winning here. But again, with all that said, this was a really solid main event to conclude the night. Roddy Piper on commentary completely shit on the Warrior, saying Warrior has no clue what he's doing, the tassels are the dumbest thing he's ever seen, and that the Warrior was prancing like a pony in the ring. Rude had this match won twice, climbing to the top before hitting a move. Once he hit it, second time he didn't. Warrior would make his comeback. He escaped the cage over the top, landing on the floor to win, as the Ultimate Warrior defeated Rick Rude in 10 minutes, 5 seconds to retain the World Wrestling Federation Championship. SummerSlam 1990 is the definition of a down-the-middle show. You had some really bad stuff, but you also had some really good stuff. The key here was the three top matches of the night: Hart's Demolition, Hogan Earthquake, and Warrior Rude. All three matches delivered. Plus, you had a solid opening match, you had the good moment of Tornado winning the Intercontinental Championship. Those things make this show at least watchable. You can skip a ton of this stuff, but don't skip the opener, the IC title match, and the three major matches on this night. So if you've never seen SummerSlam 1990 before, I give it a slight recommendation. At the very least, see it to say you have seen every SummerSlam in order. Now it's time for the Golden Ring Bell and Brown Ring Bell for WWF SummerSlam 1990. I give the Golden Ring Bell for Best Match to the Hart Foundation vs. Demolition, and I give the Brown Ring Bell for Worst Match to Dusty Rhodes vs. Randy Savage. So share your thoughts on SummerSlam 1990 in the comment section below. You got any questions about this show? Ask them and I'll answer via reply. Which match did you think was the best on the night, and which did you think was the worst on the night? And which match should have gone last and why? Hogan Earthquake or Warrior Rude? Until next time, peace.
Since 2017, From the Vault has covered various wrestling topics from the past, like pay-per-views, wrestler retrospectives, and much, much more. Make sure to subscribe and click the notification bell. Whatever episodes you're actually listening to, whether current or archived, don't forget to like, comment, and share. And last but not least, like him on Facebook, follow him on Twitter. Be sure to support, because you will get tons of updates on future episodes there. All links are down below, so what are you waiting for? Go enjoy. Bye.